Folks, welcome to another prospect interview here on the No Ceilings NBA YouTube channel. I am Maxwell Baumbach, and today I am joined by one of the most interesting and exciting prospects coming up here in the 2023 NBA draft, Washington State's Mouhamed Gueye. Mo, how are you doing today?
I'm great. I'm doing good. How about you?
I'm doing great. I'm really excited to talk to you. You were a guy that I feel like I was kind of sleeping on a little bit as a prospect. And I tweeted the other day, I was doing a film dive and I was like, man, this guy's better than I gave him credit for. And then as soon as I tweeted it out, I had all these people like associated with Washington State, whatever, hitting me up and being like, oh, he's a great guy. He's putting in the work. He's getting so much better. And then ended up being able to link up with you and get you on the show. So we're super excited to have you here. So the first thing I always like to ask is, because we get a lot of people that start coming to our website, coming to our YouTube channel around the time of the draft, and they're people that are just NBA fans and they've never even seen some of these people play before. So how would you describe your game to someone who's never seen you play before?
Describing my game, I would say I do a lot of everything. Last season, Washington State put me in a position to have the ball a lot, so I was able to make decisions. Like either I'm aggressive, either I pass the ball or organize the offense. So I would say I do a lot of everything on the game.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. He is around 6'11", very versatile. You measured with a big wingspan too at the combine, right? Wasn't your wingspan close to 7'4"?
He was 6'3" and a quarter or something like that.
Yeah. Yeah. So big, versatile player. Really, really interesting. So how did you get into basketball growing up? Because if I'm not mistaken, I believe you grew up in Senegal, right?
Yeah, I grew up in Senegal, West Africa. Was a soccer player my whole time there. Mm-hmm. I was 14, 15. But we have to say that my brother played basketball.
Okay.
To play too. But I was more into the soccer side, you know, because I was really skilled. Mm-hmm. Senegal, like, it's a soccer country. You were born the next day, you know, like, everybody give you a soccer ball. So playing soccer till I was 14, then start picking basketball a little, going with my brother, watching him play, you know, having a ball back home too. And I had cousins who was born in here. He played at Rice. He saw me too. He was like, yo, you need to start. I had a cousin who went overseas playing in Spain and all that, Sweden and all that. So it was like, yo, you got to start. You know, you're pretty tall. But that was being told by all my friends. That's how I picked it up. I had a coach. My brother took me to a camp. A coach named Coach Dom. He was a national team assistant coach. He was my first coach. That's my first time training basketball, really. Trained there for a year. Then next thing you know, Sal Mamadou, he's a coach from France. He was like, yo, I think you can be a good player. Like, I think you have potential to play in the NBA. That's how I ended up in Prolific. I was there my sophomore and junior year. Then I graduated early for Washington State.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Went there, played there freshman and sophomore year. Now I'm here.
Yeah, that's crazy. That is very fast to go from like not even experienced to playing Division I to now like a guy who is projected to go in the draft. Like that is a very, very quick turn of events.
It was very fast.
Was there anything that you feel like you gained from playing soccer that carried over into basketball?
Yes. I was playing midfield, so I would say the vision. Mm-hmm. Definitely is the same. Like, you see things. And I think that helped with my passing. Also, I think the footwork.
Absolutely.
I think that's one of my biggest strengths, my how I move my feet. And I think that helps a lot, the footwork. Mm-hmm.
So what was the biggest adjustment for you? Not only, obviously, like you go from just starting basketball to playing at one of the top high schools in the country, to Washington State. What were the biggest adjustments for you on the floor and off the floor in terms of like, now you're moving, now you're playing organized basketball at a super high level. You're in a completely different country. Like, I'm always just so blown away by the guys that moving to a different country is like a huge adustment, but then also like you're just getting thrown into the deep end basketball wise too.
And it was crazy too. My high school year, I had Jalen Green, Nemari Burnett, Coleman Hawkins, Frank, Mongo, and Mike.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
We were all in the same team. I was like, yo, this is my first taste of high school. I thought all the high schools was like that. Little do I know, it was way different.
Mm-hmm.
I adapted pretty quick. I don't know how I adapted, because that was my first time playing organized basketball ever. But I adapted really quick, started playing, you know, start playing like a month and a half until when I got here. A month and a half later, started playing with the team, started playing in games. We played, I remember my first game I played was in Arizona against Beauchamp.
Okay, yeah.
Beauchamp, and Namari hit the game winner. It was crazy. That was my first game I played ever.
That's so wild. That just like your first game and you're like on the floor with like multiple NBA players. Yeah.
It was crazy. But then I was just trying to learn, having trouble, because the language barriers was, I was not speaking good English when I first got here. So
okay.
I was speaking okay English. So it was hard to communicate with defense and all that. So, but I think besides that, just moving with the whole different, because I had a family, and thank God they helped me a lot, and being around helped me on everything. But I would say definitely the people and the food are the
best. Is there like a food that you miss the most, like being here that you just can't get?
Oh yeah, my mom's food. For sure, my food with my mom, that's the thing I miss the most.
Absolutely.
But here and there, if I go to New York, like now I'm in Atlanta, I can go to a little spot real quick, get some food.
Nice. But
my mom's food for sure.
That's a good answer. She's gonna like that one too, so I'm sure she'll appreciate that. So what led you to Washington State during the recruiting process? Like, what made you ultimately decide to go there?
Man, so it was during COVID year. So
yeah,
I go have in-person visit. Mm-hmm. So all my visits was Zoom visits, all of them. So I had Wazoo, I had UCLA, Rutgers, Kansas. I had all the schools, but the Wazoo one made more sense because where I'm coming from is like, I didn't play a lot. I didn't play a lot of games. So I'm aware that I can compete to play right away and not wait. For instance, like, say I go to UCLA, they bring a 5-star. Even though I'm going to be competing, no, I will play. But, you know, it's different when you just started and you're not from here. It's a lot. So I was like, yeah, I'm going to go to Wazoo. I have my guy SA there. I was like, I'm going to go there, prove myself, and earn me a spot. Then I did. Then thank God it worked pretty well.
Yeah, it did. It did. So you got on the radar pretty quickly as a freshman. Like, you kind of came a little out of nowhere. Like, you were a top 100 recruit, but it was sort of back end. Like you said, you weren't a guy who was getting a ton of minutes and stuff in high school. It was mostly just like, and then all of a sudden, like, you have a really, really solid freshman season. And then you got the NBA Combine invite last year. You played at the Combine. You were really good. And it was one of those things that was just like, oh man, like, this guy's serious. Like, he kind of came out of nowhere and he's really on the map. What did you take out of the NBA Combine experience last year, and what kind of feedback did you get? And then what ultimately led you to decide to go back for a second year?
I took a lot, and just going through the draft process, you know, working out with teams, seeing pros work out, it just gives you a taste that, like, you have to do this to be better or to get to that level. So I took that with me, and also, you know, just competing against your peers. Like, I'm not from here. I've been here, like, but from then, it was like 2 years.
Yeah, yeah.
I was back home. I see people like, oh, this he going to be this in the league. He going to be that in the league. Then you go against them. It was like, oh, hold on. I'm pretty good if I go against them. Go like that, you know? So just going there, competing against them, and seeing where your level is. Seeing that, you know. Because I'm not from here, obviously I'm not going to get the same politics. But if I long time, it will be a different story. So just having that confidence with you going back to the whole draft process, I think that's where I get the most confidence and what it takes to be good.
For sure. And it showed up on the film. I feel like that you were a much more confident and much more assertive player in your second year, especially down the back half of the season. So let's kind of get into your game a little bit. So obviously, like, one of the biggest things that jumps out about you is there aren't a lot of guys that have your fluidity, your mobility. at your size. Like, there's just not a lot of guys that move like you do. But I thought the other thing that was a noticeable jump to me was it seemed like you got a lot stronger and you were a lot more willing to engage physically this year than last year. Like, this year felt like, oh man, this guy's like kind of a force on the glass. And I didn't get that freshman year. So can you talk about those changes a little bit to, because obviously you got a lot stronger, but you didn't lose anything as far as how you move either.
Yeah. So that was my biggest thing coming back. It was like, yo, I need to get stronger for sure. Cause I know how it went last year going against and I know what was coming this year too. So that was my main focus, honestly, just get stronger and not lose like how I move or my handle or nothing. So the off season was pretty tough. Got Coach Shaw, he was giving me smoothie all the time. Zach, there was Coach Smith, there was on my ass. Like, oh, you got Then it kind of showed. I played like 212, 213, something like that. And I, a freshman, I was 193 when I first got
there.
So I put in like 18 or 19 pounds, something like that. So that was definitely a big change. And it helped me too. It helped me with the injuries, like getting stronger, less injury. A lot more. And, you know, I'm more durable. I don't think I miss any game the whole season.
And do you feel like that helped you just from a confidence standpoint too, to know that like, because to me where it showed up most was your rebounding. Like, you were a lot better, especially on offensive rebounds this year. Like, were you feeling like more confident too? Like, I know I can go in there and get this ball.
Yeah, definitely. I felt like every offensive rebound, I could get it, honestly. That was my mindset. Even if they box me out, I'm going to find a way. Like, you gotta find a way. That's what they always say. Find a way to get it. Find a way to get it. Obviously, they big bodies in the Pac-12. The fives are, you know, really strong. Like my boy Dante, Adam, and all them. But
yeah, Dante's good.
Yeah, you just gotta find a way. And that was my mindset. I was like, yo, I'm tall enough, and now I'm strong enough. They cannot stop me getting to an offensive rebound.
Yeah, and so another area of your game that I think makes you really interesting is because of how you move, you're going to be able to cover multiple positions and things like that. But I think you really showed a lot more as a shooter and as a passer over the last couple of years too. So you're shooting around 28% from three, which is a really good number for a big man your age. And you shot free throws a lot better this year. You went from 49% to about 67%. So could you talk a little bit about that jump as a free throw shooter and then also just your jump shot as a whole? Because you're not somebody that like teams can leave open on the perimeter, which is not something that's common in big men for one, and two, not something that's common in big men who kind of have the defensive versatility that you do.
Man, I'm still pretty mad about my free throw. I was like, man.
Not good enough. You went up 20-some percent and you're like, nah, not
terrible. I was really mad at myself because I knew, and everybody on the team knew that, oh, he's a better shooter than that. But I guess it was just my being a freshman, figuring it out. But I was pretty mad. Then this year, too, I shot it better, but I'm still not happy about the way I shoot it. But nonetheless, it's a lot of work. Like, during this offseason, put a lot of work in with Coach Shaw. He's like the free throw guy, free throw rehab. That's like he called him. And literally like 100 feet. So sometimes it get too easy. Okay, don't touch the rim. No rim, just net, all switch. You know, just keep working on it, repeat. And I think that it's pain. It's not all the way there yet, but it's on the way. Just like my shooting, I've been working on my shooting since my freshman year. My freshman played a lot. But I've been working on that since then. And obviously, I keep working on it. I'm working on it still. And I'm still going to work on it. But I know I can be a good shooter. Like, I know I can be way better than I am right now. And I will be for sure. It's just a matter of timing when you're going to click.
That's awesome to hear. Yeah, because I like the way, I mean, it looks good on film is the thing. So it's definitely on the right track. And it's exciting to see.
Yeah, and I know the work I put in definitely won't pay on the shooting. It's going to be rewarding for sure.
That's awesome. That's great to hear. So the other big area, and I think the most surprising one to me is I kind of did my film deep dive. So I saw you a couple times throughout the season, and then I just did my deep dive the other day where I'm watching, you know, four or five games of a guy. And it's what really blew me away was your passing is so much different. Like, that was not really a part of your game at all a year ago. And now you're like orchestrating handoffs, you're finding cutters. You went from 0.5 assists per game to 1.9 per game. You had an assist rate of 14, which grades out exceptionally well compared to like other big men, like other NBA players that had that kind of assist rate in college. You're looking at guys like Jeremiah Robinson Earl, Wendell Carter, Brandon Clark, like guys who are regarded as really smart, sharp passers.
Yeah.
And you went from like a non-passer to kind of being in a tier with those guys. So what happened there? How did you kind of make that leap as a passer?
Honestly, just having the ball more and Coach Smith putting me in the position to make decisions. Cause I would say I was always a great passer, but I was not. They didn't hand me the keys to that last year because we had Mike, Ty. We had a really guard dominant team the first year. Then this year it was, Coach just stressed me to run the offense. So it was like, okay, I'm gonna be patient, find the right read, and find the open guy. And I think that was the biggest difference, just me having the ball more.
Mm-hmm. So you would say a lot of it is like comfort and everything too.
Yeah, it's definitely comfort. It's having the ball and comfort, like having the ball for sure, but then being comfortable, like, you know, not rush it and get used to it. Like the first time we run the offense in the preseason, I was not used to it. I was always, I want to do this fast, I want to do this quick. Then it teaches me to take my time and see all the reads. I think being patient is one of the big things too, being patient. And honestly, after that, you just kind of roll with it. When the season's going on, you get kind of used to it. You know what your teammates going to do, the good they're going to do. You're going to, who's going to be open, and it's just read at that point.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. One thing I thought was interesting too is this is now the second year in a row that, like, not only, I mean, you obviously improved from your freshman season to your sophomore season, but you got better throughout the year. And like your in-conference stats were better than your stats at the start of the season, even though you're playing in the Pac-12. It's a really tough league. And this year had a lot of quality bigs in it too. Between like Infali Dante, who you mentioned, and then even guys like Vincent Iwachukwu and Adembona, like it's just a loaded conference on the big man front. What do you attribute that to? Is that just kind of the same thing, just getting more and more comfortable on the floor?
Yeah.
Or was there anything that clicked at all?
Yeah. Getting more comfortable and being like, and knowing like, oh, I can go out there and get a double-double every day, or I can get a bucket every day. Just being confident and more patient, I think that changed a lot of my game. And, you know, having the trust of your teammate and the coaches too, that changed a lot. So knowing that, okay, I can mess this up, but the coach trusts me to make the right pass in the next one or the right play on the next one. Either me passing the ball, shooting it, or just attacking. I know, like, oh, he trusts me to make that decision. So having that freedom in your mind, it opens up your game for sure.
For sure. Yeah. Yeah. So the season is in the books. And now we're headed into the NBA draft. We are basically 2.5 weeks away by the time this comes out. What have you been focused on working on in your game the most as you head into the draft?
Definitely shooting, because that's the biggest question they have. Like, can he shoot and all that? And I think I improved it a lot, and I showed it on my workouts too. Mm-hmm. But honestly, just getting stronger too, my ball handling, just honestly, I'll work on my game overall every time. Just everything. Mm-hmm. Like, even the aspect people think I'm good at, I think I'm not good at there yet. I think I can get better. So I work on my game overall, everything, getting stronger, shooting the ball better, ball handling. Just show the whole package, like they say.
Mm-hmm. And what do you envision your role being in the NBA? Do you see yourself as a four, as a five, as sort of a hybrid 4-5? Like, what kind of role do you see yourself playing in the NBA?
It depends, because the league now, I mean, even the five is the point guard.
Yeah.
You don't have your position. So that's why I don't want to say, oh, I want to play this or that.
Mm-hmm.
I just think I can play a lot of position, if not every position.
Mm-hmm.
And every position. I think, you know, just I think I can play pretty much every position if I was in the league right now, because it's different. It's not like, oh, he a four, he only can play four.
Yeah.
Or he a five, he only can play five. I think I can bring the, you know, how mobile I am and how I move my feet and how I play defense. I think that'll make me able to play multiple positions.
For sure. For sure. I would definitely agree with that. And like, to your point, I mean, look at the NBA Finals we have right now. It's Nikola Jokic, who runs the offense as a center. It's Jimmy Butler, who's the size of a wing, but can guard bigger players and also run the offense. Like, it's a new era. It's positionless basketball, and you kind of fit where the league is going with your shooting and your movement and your defense. And really, really exciting player. I'm so glad that you took the time to join us. We're glad that you were able to come on the show. Where can people find you on social media if they want to continue to follow your journey as you take those next steps and move on to the NBA?
Yeah, they can find me on Instagram, Rasul Mohammed, Rasul Gueye. If you put Rasul Gueye, you'll see me. I'm also on Snap, Rasul Gueye 12. And I'm on Twitter too, Rasul Gueye, but I'm more of a watcher on Twitter. I like watching people.
Sounds good. Yeah. Sounds good. Well, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I say I don't be posting it. I just be watching Twitter.
Sounds good. Well, yeah, I'll make sure that no one on our site says anything bad about you, because they'll know that you're going to see it. Yeah. You can go after him. But we appreciate you so much for taking the time, man. We're wishing you the best luck in your pre-draft process. So everyone, go give Mo a follow. If you haven't watched his film, go check it out. He's a really, really intriguing prospect here. Make sure you're subscribed to our YouTube channel here. Make sure you're subscribed to our Substack at NoCeilingsNBA.com, as well as the No Ceilings NBA podcast feed. I'm Maxwell Baumbach. Thank you for joining us.